2023 Planning Board meeting of Cape Elizabeth. The first order of business this evening is consideration and approval of the minutes of the previous meeting, November 16, 1993. Is there any discussion, comments, corrections? Judy?
I guess a first general question is, did we have a page 7? Did this end at 6, not talking about adjournment? I want to make sure.
It should be a page 7. It should be.
Maureen, could I see that quickly?
I don't have it with me. I have to.
Allison, send your copy down.
Could I scan this quickly?
Sure.
Anyone else had comments?
Any other board, sorry for the delay, but do any other board members like to take a look at the, there was a short section of page 7, which our copy ended on page 6. Sounds like there's no corrections in the first 6 pages. Are there any other corrections? Comments?
I just scanned that quickly on page 3.
Mm-hmm.
Fourth paragraph down, looks like about, I think it's maybe the third sentence. It starts at the end of the third line. She would like to see it stated for the record. She sees an apparent attempt not to meet the ordinance except to make a reference, and I would insert, to the standard.
Make a reference?
To the standard.
To.
Oh, thank you. First word in that paragraph should be Ms. instead of Mr. Lardner. Page 4, second paragraph, typo in the last sentence, they feel that they have met the standard instead of meet. The third paragraph, to clarify that, I would suggest the first 2 sentences read, Ms. Lardner said when the motion was made containing the findings of fact, it had originally been drafted to read that they did not meet that standard, period. The motion she proposed said that they substantially met the standard. Page 6, looks like the 5th paragraph beginning with Mr. Parkhurst asked. The last sentence of that would read, Ms. Lardner said that the latter was her intention. And in the second paragraph under Cranbrook subdivision amendment, there's a Mr. Lardner and Mr. O'Meara that need to be corrected.
You like doing that, don't you, Alice?
I must have been hurrying.
Thank you.
Gotta throw a couple of those in there just to make sure people are reading this. Anything else? Thank you for bearing with us. I just want to read that. Any other board members care to look at the last page? Okay. Any other comments? If none, do I hear a motion?
Mr. Chairman, I move that the meeting notes be approved as amended.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Any further discussion? All those in favor, please raise your right hand. Those opposed? The minutes are passed unanimously. Thank you very much, Alice, once again. Next order of business is to review the correspondence received during the past month. Received a letter, and I think everybody on the board received a copy of the letter to myself and the board from town legal counsel in reference to application completeness. Urge members to keep that in your packet or your notebook. It's a good reference. Next, an article or an opinion, I should say, from Orlando, I don't know how to pronounce the last name.
DeLogue,
on the taking issue. There's several good references in there. If the members may want to keep that as well. Next, the shoreland zoning news, and Sometimes these are a little bit difficult reading, but there, this time around, there's some good information, not that there's not always good information, but it's pertinent to shoreline zoning. Also attached to that is a pretty good summary, if you take the time to read, it's the last page, both sides, 1993 amendment summary. Next, the New England Resources Conference brochure. I don't know if anybody noticed the Honorable Mr. Tim Eichenberg, speaker at the conference. I made that title up, by the way. Tim was a past member here on the board, planning board, as one of the members of the panel. Environment and Development newsletter from December of this year. A memorandum from, again, myself to Michael McGovern explaining the planning board's request to review the town center zone issues first and then move on to the sewer policy. Due to the difficulty of handling both of those items at each workshop, they're both fairly large projects. There's a letter that was on the podium tonight addressing that issue from Mr. McGovern, I'll get to in just a second. Letter from Town Manager Mike McGovern to myself and the Planning Board dealing with sewer zoning amendments. There are copies that you may want to keep for Chapters 19. Minutes I thought was very nice for the Cape Elizabeth School Building Committee to include us in their distribution of building committee minutes. I believe they're also meeting tonight upstairs and would hope that they keep us in tune. Not mention the correspondence, but something that the board should make sure they keep hold of is the tentative planning board schedule through April with a list of potential agenda items. On the podium tonight was a letter from Rick Chenet in reference to the Tides Edge Road Muldoon project, requesting that matter be removed from tonight's planning board agenda due to numerous items. Dated December 16th, a letter from Mike McGovern to myself and the board. I believe, I haven't read this in full, but I believe it just indicates that the town council feels that the sewer policy is a priority and that they will, I believe, perhaps through the Sewer Ordinance Advisory Committee to do some preliminary work and hopefully the bulk of the work, which they state they will do, and that will be a great help to us.
Mr. Chair?
Yes, Judy?
I have a question on that. I'm somewhat confused because we've called it the sewer policy project or what have you, and this is how it's termed, but we were also talking about it involved identifying growth areas in the town. Is that the intention, that another board would be doing growth areas?
That's not made clear to me, and this is the first time I've seen this letter. And so I think that's a good question of the council or the town manager. It does state, I believe, that we'll be kept apprised of progress.
I just as one planning board member, anything having to do with sewer policy, I have no problem with the way the town is doing this. Not that I was saying it anyway, but if the identification of growth areas is involved in that charge, I would like to, I guess, have some input to the council, because that is the comprehensive planning function.
It most certainly is, and I think if we're not included in that, we should raise a proverbial stink about it. I mean, that's the role of this planning board. It has been a top priority of the town council, the sewer project, but it also has been their top priority for well over 5 years. And in a month and a half, we're getting a great deal of pressure to finish that up, and I understand their urgency, but they also asked us to do two large projects at once, and we just can't do that in two meetings per month. I'll make a note here to request written copy of the minutes, if we could, of that meeting, to make sure that we are kept apprised monthly on what's happening there. Also on the podium tonight was a letter from Phil McGoldrick, fire chief here in town, and to Maureen, our planner, in reference to the Cumberland Farms. I didn't have a chance to really look at this, but it seemed to indicate, I'm sorry, there are two subjects here, one Cumberland Farms and the other the Muldoon Public Access Waiver, which has been struck from the agenda. A comment on Cumberland Farms, which board members might throw into the Cumberland Farms stack for future reference. Also on the podium tonight, a letter from Richard Walker to the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board in reference to the Muldoon Public Access Waiver Review. I have not had a chance to read this at all. I would say in general, it just describes some concerns that Mr. Walker has in reference to that, and I think, again, that should be, board members should just include that with the pack that we'll use in the future. I was going to say lastly, but it's next to lastly, if that's a term. A letter December 20th to Maureen from Rick Chenet. Again, I have not read this. I assume that this is Mr. Chenet's, Attorney Chenet's response to the request for a written explanation of how this project meets the provisions of 16.3.1.Q. I have not read that, and board members should take a look at it. Also, on the podium tonight, a letter dated December 20th from T.Y. Lynn International, from Fred Morin, town engineer, to Maureen in reference to the Beals Ice Cream site plan. Again, I have not had a chance to take a look at this at all, and I think that simply move that down into the packet. I think tonight perhaps gives some indication that the planning board is not necessarily required to be here for a long period of time before the meeting starts, and when we have five or six items on the podium, it's very difficult for applicants should understand it's very difficult to necessarily take a look at all of that information before you have a chance to entertain agenda items. Is there any other correspondence from board members? Seeing none, we'll move on to old business. The first order of business this evening is the Wild Rose subdivision, a request by Hilda Cushing Dudley for a waiver of subdivision rights of Wild Rose, a five-lot subdivision located in the vicinity of Ocean House Road and Spurwick Avenue. I believe this is Mrs. Dudley approaching the podium.
Excuse me, Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
I'm not quite sure what I should do, having excused myself in the past from this project, and there is a continuing issue going on with myself and the former owner of this property. So I think it would probably be safer if I just step down.
Okay. Any objections from the board at issue? No. Peter, I'll appoint you as a voting member on this issue. No further ado, Mrs. Dudley. If you could just give us a real brief, we've received a lot of written description and so forth, what you're requesting the board, and if you could just give us a brief summary.
I'm requesting a waiver of the subdivision rights of Wild Rose, which is a five-lot subdivision located in the vicinity of Ocean House Road and Spurwink Avenue.
Okay. Thank you. Any questions, either of Mrs. Dudley or questions of the planner or myself? Questions in general? Seeing none, do I hear a motion?
Mr. Chairman?
Judy?
I'll propose the following motion for the board to consider. Findings of fact. One, the owner of the Wild Rose subdivision, Hilda Cushing Dudley, has requested that the planning board waive the subdivision approval previously granted on the lot located in the area of Ocean House Road and Spurwink Avenue. 2, approval of a waiver of subdivision has been recommended by the town attorney as an appropriate method to abandon the subdivision approval. 3, the request of the applicant does not contradict the purpose and intent of the comprehensive plan or the subdivision ordinance. Therefore, be it ordered that based on the information provided by the applicant and the advice of the town attorney, the request of Hilda Cushing Dudley for a waiver of the Wild Rose subdivision located in the vicinity of Ocean House Road and Spurwink Avenue be granted.
It's been moved. Do I hear a second?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Any further discussion? Seeing and hearing none. All those in favor of the motion as read, please raise your right hand. Those opposed? It's a unanimous vote. Thank you very much for coming before us.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you. Next order of business this evening is Beals Ice Cream, a request by Peter Malia for the site plan review of a change of use from a farm and fish market to an ice cream store located at 330 Ocean House Road, site plan review, section 9-2-10. The applicant or a representative of the applicant could come forward. See, we're really wired for sound here tonight. Even the plan gets its own microphone.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Pete Malia. I'm here on behalf of the applicant, Pete Malia Sr., once again. At our last meeting, there was much discussion about the parking arrangement on our site plan. And there were almost as many differences of opinion as there are planning board members. The applicant met with the town planner, who was very helpful in identifying the 6 specific issues which definitely needed to be addressed. And those issues have been addressed on the site plan, and those are at least 6 inches of loam will be used in areas where we apply loam. The parallel parking spaces have been lengthened to 20 feet. Railroad ties will be placed at the edge of the parallel parking spaces and grass. The approach to parking space number 1 and exit from parking space number 15 will be at a 30-degree angle. Parking spaces number 4 and 5 will be reserved for cycle use. And the turning radius is at least 20 feet around the driveway, and that, all of that is on the plan as it currently exists. Quite simply, we feel as though we have addressed each of the issues which were raised at the last meeting, and we come here tonight seeking approval of our site plan application.
Thank you very much. Are there any questions, discussion, excuse me, from the board? Stephen?
One question. Has it been determined yet as to what degree the site will be used and for what purposes seasonally?
The site will be year-round, and it will be an ice cream takeout stand.
It will only be that, or will it be something in addition to that?
Was my understanding that if we intended to do anything in addition to that, we would have to come back here before the board and seek approval. So as of right now, we are simply seeking approval of an ice cream takeout stand operated on a year-round basis.
Thank you.
Other questions? Comments? Judy?
I guess I'll just say for the record, I was disturbed that we still don't have a checkoff from the town engineer, and that one queried even further, we have a new memo stating that he still is lacking information, and he details what that information is that he would like to see on the plans.
Thank you. Just for the record, I think, Judy, you're referring to the letter that was on our, at the podium tonight?
Yes, dated December 20th.
For the town plan, did the applicants have a chance to see this letter?
I just handed it, about 5 minutes ago.
Okay.
I asked the town engineer to prepare this letter. It's not something he usually does, but it seems that the provision of specific details has been an issue for many months, and I asked him to make a list of the specific items that he expected to be included in details.
Any other comment or questions? If there are none, do I hear a motion?
Mr. Chairman.
Tom?
I move that the board consider the finding of fact 1. Amalia family is requesting site plan review of a change of use from farm and fish market to an ice cream store located at 330 Ocean House Road. 2. The plan was deemed complete April 1993 and a public hearing was held in May 1993. 3. The plan depicts site changes such as construction of parking lots, extension of driveways, and landscaping, which must be constructed to be in compliance with site plan approval. 4. The expansion of use of the site, which is not currently anticipated, could impact site design and require site plan review. And 5. The plan substantially complies with the site plan regulations of the zoning ordinance, section 19-2-10. Therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of the Malia family for site plan review of a change of use from a farm and fish market to an ice cream store located at 330 Ocean House Road be granted, subject to the following conditions. Condition 1, that the site shall be constructed as depicted on the plans and no revisions to the approved plan for the site shall be made due to the description of site changes as minor. 2. That any change of use of the shed or other than as storage shall require planning board site plan review. 3. That an escrow account be established by the applicant in a form and amount acceptable to the town manager and town attorney to be used to pay site development inspection costs by the town engineer. 4. That all changes to the site which are depicted on the approved plan shall be complete as certified by the code enforcement officer and town engineer prior to any change of use of the site to an ice cream store. And I'll add condition 5, that appropriate details be added to the plan in accordance with the town engineer's letter and attachment dated December 20, 1993.
It has been moved. Do I hear a second?
I'll second.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion? Judy?
I have a question for the town planner. Did you have any sense whether the town engineer would be comfortable receiving this information on the plan after the fact? Do you know if it's more of a record-keeping thing, or is he trying to evaluate whether the parking lot will actually work?
I think what he's trying to do is head off any problems with the construction of the parking lot in advance. And if you look at a site detail and it shows, typically he tends to find discrepancies between the design and the details. Sidewalks that don't match in terms of grade, those kind of details. And I think that's why he usually asks for these things. If you're proposing to put in 6 inches of gravel, you may be changing the drainage slope for some reason. I don't think it's a problem making these a condition of approval.
Your sense from him?
My sense from him.
Okay. Then I guess I would ask you, Tom, if you would have any concern amending your motion to specify under the findings of facts that the ice cream store is a takeout ice cream store, and that perhaps as another condition, just that this approval is granted only for a takeout ice cream store if the applicant wishes to add a seating area, further town approvals are required.
I don't have any problem with that.
Maureen, did you get the wording of that amended change?
What I would...
I think what I'd ask is that the new, at least conditions number 5 and 6 be reread onto the record. Perhaps, Tom, if you can try to reiterate number 5, and perhaps allow Judy reiterate number 6, so that Maureen can quickly scribe those.
I guess number 5 said, in effect, add the information as requested per the town engineer's letter and attachment dated December 20, 1993, to the plans.
Do you want me to read number 6?
Number 6, Judy?
I assume it's that any conversion of the site to have seating shall require planning board approval.
I said further town approvals. Isn't the zoning board also required? It would become a restaurant.
Mm-hmm. And that would be, that would be indoor seating, I would assume.
I don't know. I just remember seeing a memo saying that ZBA approval was needed.
Right.
With seating.
Mr. Chairman, could I, before you vote, when you're done discussing, could I have a word before you do?
Oh, certainly. Did you get that, Maureen? Okay. And I think the comment you related to two different, both in the findings of fact and...
Yes.
That it be mentioned in the findings of fact and it be listed as number 6.
What I can do is revise findings of fact number 1 so that it reads, the Malia family is requesting site plan review of a change of use from a farm and fish market to a takeout ice cream store located at 330 Ocean House Road.
Okay. Mr. Malia, you had a comment or a question?
Yes. The only condition that I would like to challenge is the need for an escrow account. It's my understanding that escrow accounts are usually established for large subdivision plans or major road construction projects, such as highway ramps and things of that nature. This is simply a driveway, and frankly, we don't see any need to establish an escrow account to pay the town engineer to come and inspect the driveway. We feel that the changes being made here are not of a substantive nature and are not beyond the capabilities of the code enforcement officer of the town of Cape Elizabeth to determine whether the site improvements are in compliance with the site plan. We feel that the escrow account in this case is overkill, and we do agree that before we open our shop and sell single ice cream cone, that we would need the approval of the code enforcement officer, and if the town feels the need to have the town engineer inspect the site, so be it. We don't think that this particular, the work being done on this particular site warrants the need for an escrow account.
Thank you for your input. I guess the practice of the board has not been limited to major subdivisions. It certainly is included in minor subdivisions. I was quickly trying to think in other site plan approvals where we've escrowed funds or some type of performance guarantee. I might yield to either a board member or the planner to if you have some sense of the amount of required for the escrow.
I don't. It's whatever the formula is, 1.017% of the construction cost.
If this is something the board chooses to exercise, my intention was to speak with the town engineer and have him develop an estimate of how much he would think it would cost to inspect the site, and that money would be set aside in escrow, and any additional monies that out of that estimate that aren't used would be returned to the applicant.
My understanding that this escrow was set aside simply to pay for the site development inspection costs, not the construction.
That's right. It just provides. It's a drawdown account that mm-hmm. the town pays the town engineer with for each inspection.
I think that being the issue, that it is simply for the site development inspection costs, not necessarily construction costs.
So assuming that the town engineer, it's just whatever he charges for a site inspection, probably no more than a couple hundred bucks.
If the site is constructed according to plans, he's not going to be out there very long.
So it's not a percentage of our construction or landscaping?
No, typically an inspection fee would be set up this way. This is being proposed in a different manner.
Okay.
The whole issue of site inspection by the town engineer has been a relatively new, or at least the funding of that has been relatively new. That brings some comfort to the concern for the escrow? Not a lot, right?
Can we speak with the applicant for a second?
Yeah, sure.
It doesn't bring any degree of comfort.
Okay. Any other discussion?
No.
No other discussion. We already have a motion. It has been amended. Any question by the voting members or other members for that matter?
Steve.
Yes.
Has there been a problem with the town engineer getting paid for his inspection fees?
I'll refer to Maureen.
The reason I propose that is there seems to be a lingering problem with working out the town's specifications for site plans versus what we've been able to get on this particular plan. And this was intended to be a compromise, finding a way to be able to get this plan to move forward, even though not all the details may be on the plan. So it's unique in that typically when the board establishes fees and performance guarantees, they require an applicant to post a guarantee for the entire cost of the project, and then 3% of that estimate is set aside as an inspection fee, period. This would be, there would be no performance guarantee required, and this would only keep controls on how much time the town engineer has to spend out there.
Any other discussion? Judy?
I'm just going to say, I still feel so uncomfortable with the way this applicant has addressed the town engineer's comments all along. I'm certainly not opposed to the ice cream store here, but still deciding, I almost feel I'm going to have to vote against this motion only from a from the point of view of trying to be consistent with what we ask for applicants and get it in a timely manner. I just feel uncomfortable again voting for this, and I assume it's going to pass with major details that the engineer has not seen, and I understand it's a compromise, but I just wanted to say that.
Okay. Interesting that you raised the issue of timely manner, Judy, seeing as how I was handed this this memorandum approximately 5 minutes ago. I believe several meetings ago I attempted to present a memo to the board the night of the meeting and was told that the board does not accept memorandums the night of the meeting. So that's an interesting timely manner point that you raise. I also would like to state that we have never been in agreement with the details that the town engineer has requested. We have a site right next door, which you've all seen, you drive by every day, it's vacant. It's a driveway and it's a shack. It functioned perfectly well as a takeout shack years ago. And I would like for someone to explain to me how a typical, what purpose a typical section through the driveway and adjacent parallel parking space, including gravel depths, gravel specs, widths, grading requirements, railroad ties installation, and note that gravel requirements apply to all proposed parking area expansions would serve. I'd like somebody to explain to me what purpose a detail of the concrete wheel stops installation would serve. And I'd like somebody to explain to me what purpose layout dimensions would serve for all proposed improvements.
I'll start. Let me go down the list very quickly.
Okay, Tom.
Pretend rather than selling ice cream, you wake up in the morning and it's your responsibility to build a project with a fixed budget. You show up on the site and you look at the plan. The first rule of working with plans is you don't scale the plan. the plan's not, if the dimension isn't on the plan, then it doesn't exist. You take out your plan and you tell me where I start laying out the parking lot relative to the building. There's no information there. And how do you know how deep the gravel is? How much gravel are you buying? You don't know that unless there's a typical detail. The details are to assure that the project is constructed according to the design. And quite frankly, I'm getting fed up with your attitude with respect to the town engineer's comments, which I think are reasonable. I'm fed up with your attitude with respect to other members of the board.
You're fed up with your attitude as well.
I'm quite fed up.
Okay?
Order, order. No, I'm not recognizing.
We are withdrawing this proposal at this point, and I would expect that we revert back to the original site.
Mr. Maya, I will run the meeting. You understand that?
We're withdrawing the project.
We'll continue.
Isn't this drawn to specification?
Would the board like to continue?
How is it difficult to figure out where the...
Project withdrawn. I have no more comments.
It's absolute overkill.
The board will take a five-minute break.
And make a subdivision out of it.
Meeting's over. On the floor right now, we have a motion that has been moved and seconded in regarding to Beals Ice Cream request. Is there any further discussion?
In light of the circumstances, I withdraw the motion. If that's procedurally correct.
Robert's rules, do you know? I'm not sure, Robert Schulz. I think it's maybe better to proceed.
Yeah, go ahead.
Finish the vote. I just want to make sure that we handle the vote appropriately. I will circumvent the request to rescind the motion. I think we'll simply continue. Any other discussion?
If I might say something.
No, not at this point.
Not at this point.
All those in favor of the motion as moved and amended and seconded, please raise your right hand.
Can I ask a question before we vote?
Okay, I'll delay the vote. Sorry. It comes during discussion. That's okay. Go ahead.
If the applicant has requested a withdrawal, do we in fact need to vote?
We have a motion on the floor, and I'm not sure, according to Robert's rules of order, what the right procedure is at the time of withdrawal. And I'm simply going forward to that to make sure that if we were to vote in the affirmative and the item is withdrawn from the planning board agenda, if you will, I'm not sure legally what happens to that vote. If it is not, if it's denied or there's not an affirmative vote and another motion is made, I think that process is more clear to me as to what happens to the agenda item. I think I'd rather leave it up to the town legal counsel. If it is voted in the affirmative and the applicant withdraws, I'd let town legal counsel decide what happens to the approval, if you will. Maureen, you look like you have an answer.
Well, I guess I would just suggest to the board that if they took a positive action tonight, it would then allow the applicant some time to decide how they wish to proceed.
Or if we have a vote that's not affirmative, it simply leaves it open to tabling or dismissing or any number of things. Voting no on this motion doesn't really mean anything for the project.
That's right.
No, but if there's a vote in the negative, I would simply ask for another motion after we just don't simply get rid of an agenda item. I'd also urge the voting planning board members to understand that to deny each planning board member should have a reason why he would vote in the negative. And based on our own ordinances and regulations, why we vote in the negative. Hopefully, your own perspective of action on the board here, to give you some understanding of why you might or might not vote for this. Steve, does that answer, is that a long-winded answer? It doesn't answer your question?
No, it doesn't answer my question. It seems to me that we'd be in much better shape if we were to withdraw the motion and respect the request of the applicant to withdraw. That leaves them the option of coming back at a later date if they wish.
If you can just hold a second, I do have some Roberts rules, and I'll see if it's included in that reference at all. Is it in here at all? Yeah.
I would ask that the board ignore the previous request for withdrawal. It's been a long process for both sides, and we would ask that the motion be considered with the six conditions that were earlier suggested.
I'm sorry, Mr. Murray, I was speaking with the planner. You can repeat.
I would just ask that the earlier withdrawal request be ignored, and it's been a long, involved process for everybody, both sides. I would request, therefore, that the previous motion with the six conditions be voted upon, and
so basically, you're saying that the
withdrawal be withdrawn.
Okay. With the withdrawal withdrawn. Steve, does that make the situation any more clear? I just urge the board to understand what an affirmative or negative vote, why you make that. Are there any questions about that? Did somebody eat their microphone? Any questions? Or do you want to just proceed to a vote? Don't everybody just stare.
You're proceeding to the vote.
Okay, let's proceed to the vote. All those in favor of the motion as made and amended, please raise your right hand. 1, 2, 3. Those opposed? 2 opposed. Favorable vote in the affirmative, 3-2. Congratulations. I'm sorry that there was any outburst on either side. I think your addition to this town will be well received, and I look forward to it. Again, I apologize for any outburst. There have certainly been smoother site plans. This board looks for the interest for this town, and the site plan review and how it affects, especially we're especially sensitive to the town center area. And I personally think that your addition to this town will be well received and enjoyed by many. Thank you very much.
I apologize as well, and we look forward to serving ice cream.
Good. Thank you. The next order of business under new business, back on schedule, is Cumberland Farms site plan, request by Cumberland Farms for site plan review, the addition of a canopy located at, sorry, my bifocals are off here, 287 Ocean House Road, completeness section 19-2-10. Welcome the applicant. If you could introduce yourself, give a brief summary of what your application is about. I remind the board tonight that our first order of business with this application is a matter of completeness, and that urge the board not to become involved in substance review of technical merit, but to concentrate on completeness. Good evening.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. My name is Richard Longton, L-O-N-G-T-O-N. I'm the Vice President in charge of construction for Cumberland Farms. The application before you is to not only add a gasoline canopy, but is to reorient our gasoline presentation by creating two new dispensing islands. These two islands are intended to be covered with a canopy. The proposed islands would be here and here, set back on the site further than the existing island is currently, and in our opinion, inside of the setback requirements in this particular zone. We find the need for this to keep pace with the never-ending transition in our industry, where patrons wish to avail themselves of facilities that provide such items as an overhead canopy. The canopy also becomes an ingredient for a fire suppression system, and in the case of Cape Elizabeth, as requested by the fire chief, a mounting facility for TV monitoring cameras. In performing such a relocation, it will be a much safer installation as associated with any environmental issue, in that all associated piping from the islands and dispensers to the underground tanks will have to be replaced with new double-walled pipe. That is a state requirement when altering a gasoline installation. We ask that the plan be considered for its completeness at first. There has been an error on the plan that I would point out, and it was mentioned by a town planner, that no handicap parking is provided. However, on site and by parking space number 2 is a dedicated handicap space and ramp. The omission was that the space was not labeled. In regards to your item 11A, we had asked for a waiver, in that it is our opinion that this will not have an impact on the roadways nor traffic entering or exiting our site. There is no alteration proposed to any of those improvements, and the installation of the additional island and 3 additional dispensers, in our opinion, will not dramatically impact our business. It will increase the available fueling positions by 3. There is a letter by the town engineer indicating that the multiplier would be times 4, and I would disagree with that, since we are adding 3 additional dispensers. The additional fueling points or fueling positions will cater to customers that currently do not shop for gas at this site, and many of those customers are already on site shopping for other commodities. We offer no inducements. There's no magical power that Cumberland Farms can provide to draft a large influx of traffic to this location. And the mere fact of having 4 dispensers versus the 1 dispenser is not necessarily an invitation to draw added traffic to our site. There will be an enhancement to our gas sales, but it comes from that customer so impatient that if the 1 dispenser is being used, they do not choose to wait. And this occurs time and time again. We have asked that the criteria of contours be waived, in that we are dealing with an existing site and meeting all existing conditions. Currently, there is a concrete pad in the same locus as the proposed islands. The grade of the new pad will be identical to what is existing. All of the stormwater and inclement weather must travel over the same area. There will be no impediment, and consequently, we find no need to provide a lot of information in that regard. There has been a recycling container placed outside of the enclosure by the dumpster location. And with the board's permission, we would offer to enclose that additional dispenser or have it removed from site. The additional dispenser is not required, however, it was also another item brought into the environmental picture on trying to recycle goods. It is our understanding that our signage will be in conformance with your regulation and will not exceed the limits. In the letter dated December 10th, 1993, from T.Y. Lynn International, we do not agree nor understand item one as to the setback requirements, that they are improper. It is our understanding that the setback from the street is 40 feet. The canopy is marked so that it does not protrude beyond the front of the outermost island, and it stays inside of the setback requirement. And item two, the parking space on the handicap, we have mentioned, as well as the stormwater runoff in item three. I believe we've also covered the item four about our stormwater runoff and the traffic on item five. And as stated, the fire department's criteria will be met with the submission to the state. They must approve not only the TV cameras, the no smoking signs, but also the piping configuration and its double wall condition. I think, Mr. Chairman, that the submission is minor in nature to the site, and the impact is not severe. And we would ask that any consideration that could be granted into its being judged complete, and if possible, a submission for site plan approval performed this evening, if we could.
Thank you very much. And it's Mr. Longton, is that correct?
Yes.
Thank you for the summary. I'll open up for discussion and comment. Again, I ask the board to keep the comment to issues of completeness. We in the past have gone item by item and asked for comment as we go through the checklist in a sort of orderly way. Is that the wishes of the board tonight, or would you simply rather discuss issues as they come up? Any consensus? Okay, I'd ask that the planner walk down through the site plan review submission checklist for any comments, a little background for the planning board, and ask for comment from the board members as we go down through, please.
The first item is item 6D, the handicap parking. I believe the applicant suggested that there is handicap parking on the site. It just has not been identified on the plan. There does appear to be plenty of room to create a handicap parking space if it isn't on there. Moving down to 11A, unless there's a question on another item, the applicant has requested a waiver of submitting traffic information. The town engineer has pointed out that there will be a significant increase in the number of fueling dispensers on the site, and that this could create additional traffic impact. This is really a decision for the board to make, whether they feel that there's enough of a justification to ask for a traffic study, or whether they're comfortable in waiving that requirement. Moving down to 12A, again, the town engineer didn't find anything in the plans to suggest that there would be any kind of a drainage problem. He did have some concerns about whether or not a level slab would change the grade. Perhaps if the applicant was able to provide the information that he summarized this evening, that issue with the town engineer could be resolved.
I'll just interrupt here. I want to go back up to issues of topography. There seemed to be a level of concern, and I'm fairly familiar with the site, being a fairly regular stopper out at the Cumberland Farms, in that it's not a very difficult issue, I don't believe. It's one detail to the site plan that I would certainly like to see. But, I'd also, I think we would be amiss if the planning board did not request at least some third-party opinion on traffic flow. I perfectly well understand Mr. Longton's consideration, and I think if that is the issue, then that the numerous pumps simply will entice or incent the people who would normally drive away, that they would simply stay there and get gas along with whatever other item they're shopping for. I simply would feel more comfortable as one board member to have an independent voice saying that. Number 11D, sidewalk information. I note that the sidewalk at the apex of the intersection sort of dumps into the street there, and I understand that that would be at least partially an off-site improvement, partly, it appears it would be partly on-site, partly off-site, to continue sidewalk improvements down Scott Dyer Road to the northerly side. But it would be certainly an item that I'd want to see included. You can pick up from there. Any other comment?
Do you want us to comment on each item? As
each item, yes. I think that's the easiest way. If we just collectively, if you have comments that you'd like to, even as far as we've gone, let's sort of like draw a line right at 11D, and if there are items there, we'll sort of get caught up. Tom?
I would certainly support an appropriate traffic study. I think interior circulation is as critical as traffic impacts, taking into consideration a couple of issues. One, that there's a town center study that's been prepared that is calling for some reconfiguration of Scott Dyer Road, which coincidentally is, I don't know if this length of Scott Dyer is actually Ocean House Road, it may be. But the plan shows Ocean House Road, what we typically call Scott Dyer Road. Mm-hmm. And I fully support the town engineer's request for topography on the site. My recollection in going to the site is one travels around the existing pumps and heads up toward that concrete area. There's an extreme rise there. And I believe it may not be evident on the plan, but I think once you start pouring concrete on site, you'll find quite a grade discrepancy. One, in fact, which exists between the paved area and the between the pavement, I call it the drop-off area out in front of the door to the building near the planter. There's an extreme curb height there. I don't know how high it is, maybe as much as 8 inches. and that could be affected or improved by looking at the grades. I think looking at the grading relative to the condition of the concrete is appropriate. We're not asking you to regrade the entire lot, but just show us the through spot elevations or, and 1 foot contour interval, the area of construction.
Is that it, Tom?
Yes.
Oh, I'm sorry. Anybody else? Steve, you look like you had a comment.
11A, road information. I don't mean to disagree with the applicant, but I find it remarkable that four gas pumps isn't going to create more traffic going in and out of the site than the current number that are there. So I think a traffic study is very important for this application.
Any other comments as far as we've been? Mark?
Mr. Chair, I would also agree with the need for a traffic study. And another aspect of the grading of the site, which I think needs to be examined or at least shown, is there has been indicated some concern over handicapped parking. And given the existing cross slope on the parking lot there, if the applicant does in fact maintain the existing cross slope parking for gas dispensing, will not meet the parking criteria of the Americans with Disabilities Act, most likely, which limits a parking space to a 2% cross slope. And if the intent is to maintain the existing grading there, I think that well, we need a grading plan to see that.
Seems to be a consensus, at least on those two items, dealing with traffic and contours. Not seeing any other comment. Let's Maureen, if you could continue from 12 on 12A, and board members, please feel free to interrupt as we go down through there.
Starting with 12D, the code officer has noted that I believe that the recycling bin has been put in as part of a townwide effort to encourage recycling, and he just felt now would be a good time, one, to put it on the plan, and two, to consider enclosing it, just as the dumpster that's on the site right now is already enclosed. Unless anyone has any questions, I'll move on to 13.
Is just a clarification, is the recycling bin used for private business, or is it part of?
As far as I'm aware, it's for Cumberland Farms
right,
to recycle.
Yes. Okay. In that case, I agree. It should be, if it were enclosed and for public use, it would be less accessible to the public if it were enclosed, but I think it would be appropriate to have it treated consistently with the dumpster.
Under number 13, the applicant has put a note on the plan that the existing landscaping on the site is intended to remain after construction. I just wanted to point out that the board may want to direct some attention to the esplanade between the sidewalk and Route 77 and the recommendation of the town center plan that there be trees in that esplanade in the town center area. Moving on to number 15.
I guess, again, it's difficult to deal with completeness issues versus actual review of the plan, but I would just caution the applicant that this site has been identified as an area in the town center that's of critical nature as a gateway to the town center and has other implications regarding visual access to the town library and other major focal points in the town center. I'm not clear at this point as what I would suggest for a planting plan, but I would ask the applicant to be very careful in looking at the impacts that this proposal makes on views from the road, and that and take into consideration whatever landscaping improvements would enhance that. I guess that's enough said.
Okay.
Under number 15, the applicant had requested a waiver providing sign information. However, upon reviewing the package, it appears that all the information they would have otherwise have to provide it is already in here. The sign that's proposed is within the limits. In addition, there's a maximum amount of signage on the site, a limit of 250 feet in the sign ordinance. When that 250 square-foot limit was put into the sign ordinance, myself and the code officer and one of the counselors had the pleasure of measuring the signage on all three gas stations, and actually, all four gas stations in town. And we have a spreadsheet that shows that this particular gas station is well below their limit, so the addition that they're proposing would still keep them under the 250-square-foot maximum amount.
That was my question, Maureen. I think I saw somewhere the comment about it being under, but I didn't see where it was. Is it the only reference to the spreadsheet that you had done previously? Okay. A question that I had, does that include the window signage?
Includes everything.
Includes everything.
Including
how much under is it?
Sign that says telephone and the restrooms, everything.
I didn't want to oversee it or overlook it, I'm sorry. At the same time, it's a legitimate concern, especially, I think, considering the memo or the letter from our town legal counsel dealing with completeness issues. The only thing that I might ask, and I'm not sure it's an issue of completeness, that the figure be available to the planning board as to what the current total is. We understand that it's less than, but I think it would be helpful in the plan to have an understanding of what it actually is. I'd like to back up, if I could, to number 14. It says yes, and perhaps it's something I missed, and I don't get a chance to bring my plan up here because it gets in the way, I guess. The lighting details were given for the current or the proposed canopy, but I didn't see any lighting details and foot candle radii for the parking area number 8 through 15, and that's a current improved area, but it certainly has not, in my recollection of the last few years in this town, been used, actively used as a parking area. And I assume because of the change in location of where this canopy and the pumps are going to be, the dispensers are going to be, it will require that more parking be moved to that area. It's
not so, Mr. Chairman. There is currently no parking that is being relocated due to the island reconfiguration.
I understand that it is an existing area. I'm just asking that the lighting be detailed in that area. I think it's not used currently because it's not very well lit. This is my own.
Well,
maybe it's simply it's a long distance.
Photometric on the upper right-hand corner
but that's
of the
for the canopy itself.
Well, it's for the canopy, and it also shows the spread that illuminates this particular area.
I understand that diagram. I'm saying from
you showed
two lights. On either end, up by number 8, nope, back down the other end toward the...
There's a light here?
Yes, and one just up from that, 4 inches up to by number parking lot number 8, I believe it is.
That's correct here.
A detail of...
There was to be no change to that. They have existed for a number of years, and there was no alteration or touching of the site. That's why...
I'd ask that that detail be added to the site plan as a matter of completeness. Okay, we're on number 15. Any other comments?
I just want to back up to that. Would you also provide whatever standard you're using for light level of illumination below the canopy? There's a tremendous variation in light levels, as high as 125 foot candles out to 75 and 50 at the edge of the canopy. I assume that there's an industry standard for what foot candle level has to be achieved, either for the TV monitors or for safety, whatever verification you can provide for that.
Mm-hmm. Any other comment? Let's go on to number 16.
Before you go to 16 on 15, in looking at the site plan, close to where it says existing concrete sidewalk, there's an existing pole sign. I believe that's the corporate sign that says Cumberland Farms on it.
Yes.
Is there not another sign somewhere near there, perhaps just up on the corner a little bit, that's a taller pole sign that just has prices on it? In fact, it looks like it's half utilized.
Yes, I believe there is.
You'd add that, please.
Any Any other comments?
Is there any height restriction as to the lights for the canopy?
There would be restrictions on the canopy as a sign, I believe, because the canopy itself, because it has lettering on it, is a sign. That, there is a height restriction in the sign ordinance, and I assume that it falls, the proposed canopy falls within that height limitation. I get a nod from Maureen that says it does. Any other comments? Yes?
Keep going.
Continue.
I'm finished.
She's finished. Tom, go ahead.
Due to what I perceive may be the sensitive nature of this project, and let me just restrict that to my personal concern, would you provide a narrative with the application that speaks to the standards for site plan review? In the ordinance, there's a list of standards under which we review site plan applications. Please don't find me to be a liar.
No, it is in, let's just see if I can find it quickly. I put our new one in here, and I'm not sure, like 26, page 26 in the new section.
Standards begin on page 27.
Perhaps if you could, Mr. Longton, refer to the section. Under standards, it would be section 19.2-10C of the standards, I believe that you're...
That's correct.
Mr. Emery's looking for is a narrative summary of those standards.
Mr. Chair?
Yes, Judy?
I had a question on that, on the town engineer's memo on the second page. He says the applicant has requested waivers from the site plan review ordinance section 19-2-10C, 2A through G, and 3 through 6, which is basically all our standards we have to review an application. And I don't know if this is something erroneous, because I can't see how I could see waiving requirements that we want to look at, but not the standards themselves.
So you're looking at... states B, 2, H, starts with topography?
No, I'm looking at, on the town engineer's memo, point six, or item 6.
I'm sorry.
He said he's requesting waivers, and what he cites, 10C, 2, A through G, and 3 through 6, are our standards with respect to access, lighting, buffering, environmental considerations. Those are not things that are asked to be submitted, but what we actually use.
I think in Ms. Emery's request for, or talking about request for traffic study, talked about both the internal traffic flow and external to the site traffic flow. And do most of those items deal with internal flow traffic? Judy?
Are you asking me?
Yeah, I just flipped away from them, sorry.
Well, under the access, they do have specifications saying, you know, that driveways can't be within such a distance of a road or within a certain distance. But let me, so some of those specifics on the driveways and parking lots, perhaps we would not review because we wouldn't be looking at new ones, but things like the building and parking area design and layout, they shall provide an aesthetically pleasing design and an efficient arrangement under lighting, that adequate lighting is needed.
To do what?
I believe what the applicant has done is they've asked you to waive the submission of certain pieces of information, which is within the purview of the board to do. They've also suggested that you waive some of the standards for review, and you don't have authority to waive any of the standards for
review. Okay, thank you.
I think also in Mr. Emery's request to have a narrative in the submission of those, and those are the items I think that he was referring to in section C, that from strictly a completeness issue, just simply requesting that narrative, then we'll deal with the qualitative and quantitative issues of what's included in the narrative.
Yeah, I wasn't concerned about what's in it, just the fact that a waiver was apparently requested.
Right. Yeah. I certainly would. Concur with that. Any other issues? I would just like to say that Mr. Emery mentioned that this is a sensitive site. I think every site in our town center is being looked at closely, and I hope that you don't take our detail to the site plan review erroneously. It is a major gateway. These two properties, your property and the property across the street, form a natural gateway, and in the town center plan that was adopted by the town council, amended, adopted as amendment into the comprehensive plan, it speaks, granted minimally, but it does speak to the issue of a number of different issues. If you don't have a copy of that, I would ask that at least a photocopy be given to an, or at least a copy that be made available to you to review. As just one planning board member, I will be extremely sensitive to that issue of its compliance. As minimal as the guidelines are to improvements to the town center plan, I don't feel that we can neglect a lot of attention to that. I think the mention or the, and I'm not talking about completeness here, and I'm just in the interest of actually speeding up your application process. You hear a number of issues that we probably are going to deem to be required to deem this complete, that will be required. I think during the time that you're working on that, you need to take into account the visual corridor, specifically from Route 77 headed south as you look up across your parking lot towards what's deemed in the town center plan as a historical building, the Thomas Memorial Library. As a matter of completeness, I can't, I don't believe that there's any issue in where I can ask for photo enhancement to show a picture of that with it. Tom, maybe you can help me with the name of that that issue of drawing.
Either a Xerox montage or a computer montage where you photograph the existing facility as viewed from the travelway and then view it with the proposed improvements superimposed, including the view to the town center as depicted in the town center report.
I'm concerned specifically of that impact. I'm concerned specifically of the impact of the lighting and the mass of the canopy itself, the architecture of the canopy. I've opened this up when I'm done to other suggestions, and then while we're talking about completeness and we'll soon vote on completeness, I want to make sure that this applicant at least understands the mood of other board members as to what we'll be looking for, so you don't come back here with any surprises. I don't want you to come back in another month and say, why didn't you just tell me that up front and issues above and beyond. Just reflecting on what I will be looking for as myself, the issue of the mass and the architectural blending of that canopy with your existing building, how much it interrupts and interferes with the view across your parking lot of what's considered to be a historic building. I certainly am not here to indicate that I'm not in favor of canopy. I will say I stop at this location a great number of times every week and I'm in favor of promoting commerce in our downtown area, but I'm also extremely sensitive to the impact that this type of facility will have in our town center area. I just wanted you to be aware of that when you come back to this board. Any other comments? Judy?
Just like to say in general, thank you to Mr. Longton. I think this is a well put together plan, even though I would agree with other board members that certain waivers are not appropriate. The site plan right across the street from you where an insurance agent went in was also thoroughly done, and then we've had some ones that were not thoroughly done toward this part of the town center. So do not think you haven't done a good job. I think you made a very good start.
I'd just like to make one other comment of something that I know that probably is in the mind of the planning board members as far as being consistent with other site plan reviews of gas stations, and specifically the one across the street from yours. The time of that application, the time of that site plan review, was no town plan, the town center plan amendment adopted to the comprehensive.
Mr. Chairman, I prefer not even to talk about that.
I understand that, but I want you to understand as we proceed that, your plan will be based on the merits that, and the ordinances and regulations set at this time, just as gas stations in the future will be by those standards.
Mr. Chairman, the only few things I'd like to say, and that this has been a gas station, as you know, for a great number of years, long before we acquired the parcel. And before we acquired the parcel, there were three islands on the site. And we talk about the aesthetics of the site. Certainly, it was more objectionable, I would say, then, particularly if it were to be operated self-serve with fire suppression pipes, etc., projecting out from all islands. It has been reduced in its activity to a point to meet zoning criteria that has strapped the applicant that he is not competitive in the marketplace today. That is why we are asking for the reconfiguration. In doing that, we bring the site further into compliance with setback criteria. The concrete slab that is here, and that is the reason we asked for the waiver, still has evidence of the old island, since it was only filled in flush with the pad. The pad is there, there are some grooves around its extremities, meeting the asphalt. We will pick up the grades of that, but there's no change intended. It's the same pad. It's replacing like for like. That is the reason we ask that some of that criteria be waived from this application. Because in our opinion, in our meeting with the planner, it was our position and thought process that this was a minimal impact to the site and minimal to meet all of the criteria of site plan approval. And that is why you don't see that information that you are asking for. We will gather the necessary traffic data. I don't know what it does after getting it. It isn't a Walmart. It isn't a BJ warehouse. It's a Cumberland Farm store. They don't sell anything that creates hordes of people from Portland to drive out to shop. There are no video games to attract another transient. We offer gasoline. By no means do we have our own oil wells and cannot offer any magical inducements to create a traffic jam. The traffic has maneuvered in and off-site for a great number of years. The movements on site will not be impeded. The traffic will have adequate aisles in which to pass through and around the proposed island. The curb cuts are very conservative and are intended to remain the same. We are not asking for enlargements or relocation. The traffic study, in my opinion, and I produce many of them, will be of very little value to your deliberation. If it's a criteria that has to be met, we will do so, but to me, it is not expeditious to anything.
Okay, thank you. Any other comments? Stephen, you look like you have a comment.
Yeah, good question. I may have missed something earlier, but the top of the canopies, the edge that the public is going to be looking at, is that entirely lit?
No, it is not.
Is any part of it lit?
No, it is not. The lights are intended to be focused down from underside the canopy in a downward fashion on the paved surface or the maneuvering surface or the dispensing area.
I'd like to interrupt you, and I'm fully guilty of leading this board into the technical merit and discussion of the issues. I started us there, and I apologize for getting us in there. Good questions, but that's not the issue that's before us. I was probably premature in my comments before we even voted on completeness. I just want to make sure, open up the comments from one of the board members in trying to assist the applicant to get some mood of the, oftentimes an applicant will come to our workshop during the off meeting time during the month and get some feedback on applications. Tom, you look like you're...
Yeah, just one last comment. I think this project would have benefited tremendously from a workshop meeting. Just want to make it clear that at least from my chair, my seat, and my perspective on the project, that if I were you, I would expect a thorough and perhaps lengthy review process, that it's not as simple as it appears on paper. Again, the town center report is critical in terms of many issues, but not the least of which, and I guess I'm, this last issue that I'll raise is brought to bear every time I travel throughout the state of Maine. This is a town center that has a unique quality and character. It's not, the issue is here that we're trying to remove any sense of strip and make sure that it becomes a town center. And one thing that we'd like to see is some creative solutions toward that end. And I think that's a positive way of stating that I, as one member of the board, would like to look very closely at the canopy.
Good comment. Any others before we get to a vote?
Yes. And this is sort of following along with Tom's question or statement. Have you in any other locations, and I know this is not a completeness thing, but it's something I think makes sense to think about, any of the locations anywhere in New England use a different style of canopy other than the one that's depicted in the plans?
To what style are you referring to, any particular?
Something that is less, I don't know, I don't want to pass value judgment, but something that looks less like a gasoline canopy than maybe a...
There have been A-frame roofs put on canopy.
Okay. I guess I'd like to see some possible alternate styles.
I think that's a good comment, and it certainly, as one board member, that's something that's rolling my... I think it's good for you to know as the applicant that those are the issues, and if you'd like to hear more, or certainly open up the workshop session for you if you'd like to attend. We're trying to give you some sense of direction or expectation of the board as you proceed with your site plan application. Tom?
Steve, I don't know if there were any members on the board at the time this was originally approved. And I will ask this question. I don't know if it's appropriate to ask in a public forum, if it's prejudicial or otherwise, but I want to be sure that there are no conditions of whatever review that previous applicant went through that might ride with the property that we should be aware of with this application.
That's a good question.
Was that pertaining to when it went in originally as a Sunoco or when it was put in as Cumberland?
It was my understanding that it was quite a lengthy review when it was when it was changed from the Sunoco to the Cumberland Farm.
Very lengthy.
Yes.
Any other comments at this time dealing with completeness? Seeing none, do I have a motion? Don't all jump to Judy. Thank you.
I propose the following motion for the board to consider. Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Cumberland Farms for a canopy addition at the 278 Ocean House Road location be deemed incomplete.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion?
Can I just interject one last thing? Something that's always fascinated me about people wanting to put canopies in gas stations. Is there any market study or anything that you'd be willing to share with us that gives a reason for, a logical reason for wanting to do this other than to keep up with the, you know, keeping up with the Joneses?
So to speak.
Jonesies, rather.
That was not intended as a pun.
Well, it's become an important ingredient to house, as I mentioned, the fire suppression systems, TV monitoring that has become apparent in this day and age. If you could envision placing the various items in the air on stanchions, they become very obnoxious in their appearance and unsightly. It becomes a lighting backdrop to control the direction of the spread of light, much better than island illuminators that cannot, that would be freestanding, while the fire suppression and other devices are mounted to them stanchions. And it does enhance the public's use during inclement weather. So it's an evolution of all of those items, I feel, that has necessitated most of your gas stations seeking an overhead canopy.
Thank you very much. Is there any further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion as made and seconded, please raise your right hand. Those opposed, the unanimous vote for being deemed incomplete. I would ask that the applicant, if you'd like a summary of those issues that are deemed, or if there's any question about those items that were deemed lacking or the reason for its incompleteness, either we can reiterate those for you now, or you can meet with the planner. Do you have a list of those?
Yes, I have a list, and by ordinance, I'm required to send you written notification of everything you need to present to make it complete. So you should be receiving that.
We'll begin preparing the data and then make an appointment to meet with the planner before another submission.
Okay. I urge you, if you'd like to, also attend the workshop. It's certainly open to you. If you'd like further discussion with us, I don't want any of our response to be taken negative by you. We have I would say you've presented us with a good start on a plan. You're a very clear and articulate speaker yourself, and look forward to seeing you next month.
Thank you.
Thank you. The last item under new business has been removed from the agenda this evening. Is there any other business before the board? Judy?
I just have a question about the tentative planning board schedule.
Yes.
Either I had read somewhere in the paper or just overheard that the school building project, they hope to get on our official agenda for the January meeting. Is there some possibility of that?
I saw that in the newspaper as well, and certainly if they get their submission in a timely manner, that can happen. The one thing that they're working on is they need to go to the zoning board before they come to the planning board, and by ordinance you have to have your zoning approval in hand before you go to the planning board. They are attending a specially scheduled meeting of the zoning board on the 11th. Planning board submission deadline is January 3rd, so my assumption is that they tend to be on the planning board's January meeting, that they're going to make a submission January 3rd, and assume that they're going to be able to get their approval from the zoning board on the 11th.
And they are aware of the submission deadline?
Oh, yes.
Okay.
I would like to point out that tentative agenda is prepared for the board, one, to let you know about meeting dates in advance, and also to let you know about projects that I may have become aware of, but in no way is it very specific.
Okay.
Any other orders of business tonight? Yeah, I would just like to say that sometimes the planning boards go well, and sometimes they become a little overly serious and so forth, but I think during this season especially, that the I'd like to say, and I have to put my prop on now, that I I've really enjoyed working with this planning board, and one thing I really always enjoy is looking up at the minutes and seeing under absent none. And this is a great board. It's been a great year. I look forward to heading into next year. I hope this holiday season gives everybody a chance to reflect on how grateful we can be. I wish everybody Merry Christmas and Happy New Year, and to all a good night.
Second.
Thank you. Good night.
Yeah.